Good morning, I'm Raffaella Giovagnoli from Rome, Pontifical Lateran University. I'm very happy to participate with this video, to this very beautiful event on social ontology. The title of my contribution is Habits with Intentionality and Rituals, as you can see. It derives from a contribution of the book edited by myself and Robert Lowe, The Logic of Social Practices, Springer, if you are interested in see something about. I'm discussing the notion of habits, which habit is a very important notion in philosophy. As you know, Aristotle, Aquinas, Dewey, Pascal, Hume, Hegel, Ravesson, they discuss in several ways the notion of habit. We know that habits, in my opinion, are in the I mode, can be in the I mode in the sense that each person has their own habits, but can be also in the we mode. For example, we can share a habit with our friend. To go to jogging, we don't have a ritual. We share a habit, so it's different. And then I'm very interested in some approaches which crosses philosophy and neuroscience, like Bernard Murillo, Lombo, Jimenez, Amaya. They establish a good relationship between the Aristotelian view and the neuroscience, exemplified by Susan Greibel, who thinks that we act according to our habits from the time we rise and go through our morning routines until we fall asleep after evening routines. And so she did a lot of experiments of animals and also people who have disabilities, and thinks that habits as fixed action pattern, namely complex repetitive behavior in non-human animals and repetitive behavior and thoughts in human pathological conditions, these are out of having explicitly goals. So the habit disengaged from a goal become either a stimulus response pair for animal animals or a pathological trait for human beings. She maintains that habits play an important role in social life also, and they are shaped as mannerisms and rituals. So what is important for us is this notion of habit as a goal-directed activity that in Aristotle terms means that we have an habit acquired to perform a certain types of action. This disposition usually acquired by means of repetition of one or more actions makes the exception of this action prompter more spontaneous and autonomous from continuous supervision, all of which generally leads to a better performance. And if the habit increases cognitive control of the action, it can be termed a habit as learning when we have an increased cognitive control. On the contrary, it increases the rigidity. It is a habit as routine. So we have some conclusion. Habits as routine are fundamental for the cognitive enrichment of action entailed by a variable amount of practice. Efforts are required to engage in activities and performance. But habits as learning are not merely acquisition of a way of acting, as they entail a cognitive capacity connected to the habit that can be flexibly used in different contexts. For example, the pianist who can easily read the notes from the score, a mostly theoretical habit, and whose fingers appropriately respond to this reading, a technical habit, is able to exploit the expressive possibility of the instrument. So we see the game of these two dimensions in habit learning, habit as routine. So habit as routine seems unconscious. habits, learning, reduce or eliminate consciousness of basic elements of the action in order to concentrate on higher goal, while preserving at all times the possibility of recovering them from conscious attention. So we have that the contribution of the Aristotelian distinction between good and bad habits, which characterize good habits, as those enhancing the agent control to reach precise goal. The habit as learning entail control, thus they are fundamental to reach personal goal. This process favors the agent pleasure and happiness. So this is very important. I mean, what is our relationship between habit, intentionality and rituals? Because in my opinion, a ritual can be seen habits in a we mode, so the same mechanism, the same dimension in the we mode. So they present the dimension of routine, but also the active stable disposition for action, which shows how ritual play a fundamental role in individual and social life. We'll move from a view that crosses philosophy and neurobiology as intended goal-directed activity. So we think that this provides the ground for understanding the cooperation we need to engage and to institutionalize the ritual practice in social environments. We need these dimensions. Anthropology, ethnology, sociology, social psychology traditionally investigate rituals. We use the word rite or ritual, referring especially to religion and myths, to indicate that aspect of it that makes the religious experience possible in the mystical dimension. Suggest you to read the book of Kevin Shilblack, Thinking Through Rituals, Philosophical Perspective, not very recent, but very interesting on the several perspective on rituals, philosophical, from a philosophical and cognitive point of view. So the set of acts which characterize human habits can be institutionalized to form the cultural rituals that belong to human life form. We think that rituals are institutionalized habits in the we form and have important function in our daily life. So, as I told at the beginning, I don't need to go for jogging, to go to run with my dog. We share habits, so we don't have a ritual institutionalized, okay? But if a group of people in a kind of institutionalized association want to go out for a trekking, then they can have some institutional acts to perform this activity. They deserve to share emotion, mainly derived from different contexts of experience, precariousness, danger, pain, necessity to follow cultural norm, etc. Ritual often refer entail peculiar realities, social realities, because they have some relationship with objects or artifacts. We can observe that human beings, but also other species, have the capacity to impose a function to an object, so that the object acquires a function dependent on the peculiar scope of the agent. So there is a continuity between habits and ritual, showed by the fact that human create these agentic functions in some terminology in a wide variety of situations. Also, non-human animals have the form of creating functions for objects, but there is a fundamental difference in the concept of function in the human case. Let's see what this means. I want to quote a very important thought from John Searle, Making the Social World, page 59. When we discover functions in nature, what we are doing is discovering how certain causes operate to serve certain purposes. When the notion of purpose is not intrinsic to mind independent nature, but is relative to our set of values, so we can discover that the heart pumps blood, but when we say that the function of the heart is to pump blood, we take it for granted that life, survival, and reproduction are positive value, and that the functioning of biological organs sees these values. A function is a cause that serves a purpose, and the purposes have to come somewhere. In this case, they come from human beings. In this sense, function are intentionality relative, and therefore mind dependent. What we do is to create a social habit in the form of ritual. So we need a peculiar function that I say can be status function, which is peculiar kind of function from which we create the social world. And in this sense, they are intentionality relative function, but are characterized by two special features. They require a shared intentionality, namely collective intentionality and collective imposition and the recognition of a status. So a sort of constitutive rule is essential, as you know, for institution in general. The classical status function x counts as y in C. For instance, a certain expression counts as promise in a certain constant C. So in language use is fundamental to assign function to objects and persons, you know, for creating institutional reality in general. And you know how also speech acts, and in particular the ontological part of language expressed in declaration is very very important, like this is my house, this is my coach. They represent the state of affairs and create a deontology which manifests itself in rights, obligations, duties, as well in the acceptation of the corresponding speech act from the part of the interlocutor. A very famous example of a ritual that is an institutionalized in this sense, the situation is marriage, that has a precise ritual. And for example, first we need to be moved to act in a certain way. We intentionality works when we want to do something together so that we we cooperate to achieve our common goal. A collective intentionality in this case presents a weak form, collective recognition, and a strong form, cooperation. And both are crucial in the case of the rituals, in particular in our case, marriage, because collective recognition means that the couple simply accept the institution of marriage prior to actually getting married. But the actual marriage ceremony is an example of active cooperation in which the couple enters in a new social status, acquiring new social statuses consequently to the speech act of the promise. The social context requires the speech act of a declaration from the part of the institutional figure who has the suitable deontic powers to celebrate the rite and to ascribe the new status to the couple. Again, we have two dimensions, like habit, passive cooperation, recognition of certain steps, and cooperation in a strong sense, in which there is the creation of a new social situation regulated by the ritual. In conclusion, I want to say that from a descriptive point of view, human rituals require symbolization that can be represented in different forms. We attribute a function or a symbolic value to certain objects, animals, and procedures. The object acquires a status function and counts as something that is recognized to mean something else. For instance, the ceremony to award the diplomas requires the student to dress the robe, which means the passage to a higher level of education and potential access to a prestigious university. In bullfight, people assign a symbolic value to the bull and to the peculiar uniform of the toreador. In this case, to kill a bull is not considered a good practice in every culture, like eating lamb for Easter. It seems that language, written or spoken, is a component that is not always present in ritual, less seen to dance as a performer largely present in rituals. Differently, in the tea ceremony, the ritual focuses on a codified set of sentences as well on some specific objects used to prepare the tea, so that they acquire a certain value and on the meaning on the very ritual. I thank you for the attention to this video and I hope to have answer from your part.